Well, I've brought you today to the simply incredible Rudyard Lake. What an amazing place this is. Absolutely beautiful. I love these big waters and I love them even more when they're full of bream like this place. Today, we're going to focus on all things bream fishing, long feeder, short feeder, how we can mix it up, changing methods to catch you a big bag of bream. Let's go and have a look. Once I've set myself up nice and comfy, it's about looking at the water in front of you and trying to get a picture in your mind of the sort of depths you might be faced with and where you might like to fish. Now, whenever I come to somewhere new, I always try to get a little bit of research on where the fish might like to sit. And from what I can understand, it seems to me that 30, 40 meters is a really popular distance here. So not a massive cast. And also then a longer line, probably around about 60 odd meters. That tells me that basically the fish could be anywhere. Nobody really knows, but we know roughly where they catch them. So I want to get a bit of an idea of how deep it is. And if I'm going to fish up to say 60 meters, I always like to plumb up with the longest rod. So I don't try to plumb up with a short rod and put a smaller bomb on. I try to get an idea of the general depth with one rod and one bomb. So I know with my distance master, with my 4 meter distance master, with an ounce and a half bomb, I can cast out in front of me and start to get an idea of what the depth is like. So I haven't, everything's like you see, everything's dry here. I haven't cast in at all yet. I'm gonna get a little feel with you guys for the sort of depth I'm faced with. And the first thing I always do when I start off is just give it a little underarm lob. 1, 2, 3. So I had nearly 3 seconds there on this ounce and a half bomb, and I've lobbed it 12 meters, something like that, not even far at all. So that tells you, and looking at the contours of the bank here, obviously this sort of drop goes into the water quite quickly, because a count of 3 seconds with this ounce and a half bomb is going to be at least, I would say, 9 or 10 feet. So let's chuck this bomb now. Again, it's just approximate to begin with to get a feel. Let's chuck it around about 30 meters. So just a nice steady lob. 1, 2, 3, again, 3. So then from 12 to 30 meters, it looks very, very similar in depth. Now there might be a bit of a drop off in between, but I'm just trying to get an idea. Probably like I say, 12, 15 meters I lobbed it to start with. That was about 30-ish meters, a count of 3. And I'm just, this is a rough feel. I'm just trying to get a feel for what we're faced with. So I'm gonna cast it a bit further. Let's cast it, say, about 50-ish meters. 1, 2, 3. Didn't even get to 3. So it's obviously shallower as you go a bit further out, which is what they said. So that's quite interesting as well. And it's given you an idea. This is all just to get a bit of an idea of what sort of depth you're faced with. Now, it's a lovely, lovely, lovely autumn day today. We've had a little bit of warm weather recently, and I kind of get the feeling that the fish are probably pushing into that shallower water when it's warm like this. The water feels warm, so I'm not put off by the fact it's getting shallower at distance. So this time I'm going to cast it a bit further, probably about roughly the limit, 65-ish meters. Let's just see. 1, 2, and it's hit the bottom. So 2.5 maximum. So it's obviously getting a lot shallower, it's getting shallower as we're going further out. So that is the tool I use, and that's like 4 or 5 casts, nothing particular. It's just to get an idea. So it looks to me that the deepest water in my peg is probably quite close in. So I'm not gonna have to go a long way out to sort of find that difference. Now, one thing I will say is I want to be obviously a little bit more accurate than that when I'm actually plumbing up the depth. So I tend to try and find a distance with the bomb that I like And then I'll go to my sticks and I'll mark my sticks at a distance and have a little play around from then. So I'm just going to mark the depth on my sticks and I'll come back to you and show you how I pick it up from there. So I've had a rough chuck about to get an idea. So I now need to use my sticks to be a little bit more accurate. We know as we go further out, it gets a little bit shallower. So on my longer rod, I think I'm going to go for a nice comfortable distance that I can hit all the time, guaranteed, looking at the conditions. And I don't want to go too far, because it seemed to me that if you'd have gone too far, you might run out of water. So what I'm going to do, these are 3 meter sticks. I'm going to go with 63 meters. That's what I've sort of decided. And then I'll put the bomb back on when we get back down there. And I'll just check that that's okay. Do I need to come to 60? Do I need to go to 66? Something like that. Obviously, like I said, sticks are 3 meters. So if I can, I try to keep it in 3 meter intervals. So I'm going to stick all my rods up. We'll go down back onto the bank. I'll check with a bomb to make sure the bottom's nice and clean and that everything's right there and there isn't some sort of big hump in the peg or something like that. And if there is, I can always come back and change it. But that's where we're up to, so we'll see how we're going to get on. So I've just clipped it up there at this end and we're going to wrap it around the stick. So here we go. Three. There we go, look, we're all the way back in. A very, very simple process. And I'll do that with the other rods now. And the reason sticks are so great is because I know for definite that is 63 meters. And if I set up another rod, that'll be at 63 meters. And if I crack off or have a disaster or snag up or lose something, I can just use these sticks. I'll leave these in the ground all day. And I can just pop back to them if I broke both rods and I could stick up again. It's absolutely foolproof and a must for any serious feeder angler. Let's touch a little bit on the approach for today then and how we're going to go about it. So we've looked at the lines, haven't we? We know we're going to fish 36 meters and 63 meters. But what are we going to do on both of those lines? Well, somewhere where you go bream fishing like this on these big venues or any bream water really, you have to really consider your approach and think about what you want to do in terms of the amount of bait you want to put in, sort of style of feeders you want to fish, and how you're going to work those two lines. They are the key criteria as far as I'm concerned. The first thing has to be what bait am I going to put in. So on these two different distances, I'm going to look at introducing some bait to start with, and we'll touch on that in a bit. And I'll be using this sort of style of feeder, this hex mesh cage, a nice big feeder to introduce an area of bait. Now, one thing that's important is I won't be doing loads of that. And like I said, we will look at that in detail. I'm not going to be putting loads of bait in, but so we'll put a bit of bait in on both lines and then we'll think about how we're going to approach them. Let's have a little look at the rods I'm going to use and how I'm going to go about that. So first of all, this 36 meter line, I've got an 11 foot rod here. It's a Monster X 11 foot, absolutely beautiful rod. I always try to fish with I'm not going to say the softest rod, but I try to fish with what I consider as the nicest rod possible for the distance. When you fish further out, you're going to need stronger, heavier rods. It's just a fact of where you're casting to. But this sort of nice 30 meters, I can fish lovely with an 11 foot rod, and it's a beautiful rod to use. I've got braid on my reels, which is something that I always do, but I've gone with shock leaders today. These fish are big fish, you know, they're going to be 2 to 5 pound. Bites are going to be really positive when we get one. We're not going to have to worry too much about trying to fish braid direct and read everything that's going on. So I've got a nice shock leader on there. On every single rod, I've got 7 meters of 028 shock leader, and that's 10 pounds sinking feeder mono. That's what 028 is. Okay, and it goes well onto the reel, good 6 or 7 winds onto the reel when I'm wound up here. Just how I like to fish my shock leaders. I think if you're going to put a shock leader on, get the most out of it. And that 7 meters means when I'm playing fish under my feet, I'll be totally and utterly in control of the fish. So these two rods for this distance, why two rods? Well, I suppose you could say, first of all, maybe if I was gonna go for a spare, but I've not gone for that approach today because I'm actually gonna do something slightly different today, which compared with what I've probably done for you before. And that is I'm gonna have two feeder approaches. I'm gonna have a traditional feeder approach, which we'll look at in a minute, but I'm also gonna have a method feeder. A method feeder is unbelievably effective when you come to fishing for bream on any venue. And it gets forgotten a little bit when we come on bigger venues because we tend to go back to traditional style fishing. But on venues like this, where I think there's going to be potentially quite a few fish in the peg at certain points, a method allows me to basically focus the fish on the bottom. So I've got with me a couple of different types of method feeder. I've gone for elasticated stems. Okay, so I've got the ICS system and I've got 13 hollow in here. That's what I've put in here. Not a heavier elastic like I would do for carp fishing. 13 hollow is quite forgiving and it means that I can pull nice and firmly and it's going to cushion the lunges of these fish when I get them at the net. Got two different sizes. Got the small and large and they're both in 30 gram. I'm not casting particularly far, I'm casting 36 meters. The bottom's quite soft. If I need quite a big amount of bait and I feel the fish need a big amount of bait to home in on, I'm gonna go with the large. If I tend to find that I'm catching fish quite regularly, I'll probably step it down to the small. And I can just clip those feeders on as and when I need them. Because I'm on a natural venue, they'll have nice short hook lengths on, but they'll have barbed hooks on. I do like a barbed hook on a natural venue when I'm fishing for bream, and I'll be fishing with an N30 today in either a 12 or a 14. I've also got my normal feeder setup, which you'll have seen lots of times before, but I'm gonna show you again because it's always nice to see what we're doing. It's the free running setup that I've got here. I've got a 6-inch twizzle boom, short piece of silicon there, just helping it all stand off. And I'll attach the hook length to this and I can put any sort of feeder on I want. And I will start with this. This is the sort of setup I will start with because why? Why would I do that over a method? Why not just fish a method feeder? Well, like I've touched on, a method feeder is very, very direct. It's all a little package on the bottom. Whereas when you fish with a traditional feeder, you can vary the length of your hook length, maybe a meter long, half a meter, and I'm sure that the fish actually see your hook bait falling through the clear water that we're fishing in today. So there is a big advantage of using those type of feeders when you're trying to draw that fish down to the bottom. And I'll be fishing with small hex mesh feeders, medium hex mesh feeders like this, and possibly the old favorite, would never go anywhere without, I've got the windows caged and solid. So I've got a really nice choice there of feeders to go at. These are my feeder choices and it makes life easier. You've got to remember, weight down at the bottom helps you with your casting. You're going to be able to cast nice and accurately. Got a range of weights and sizes, 30 gram all the way up to 60 gram if conditions change. And I'm going to start on that line. I'm going to start at that 36 meter line. I'm going to put a small feeder on after I've put the initial bait on and just see what happens. We'll feel our way into the session. Now on the longer line, 63 meters, everything's got to be geared up. Okay, so I've got the 4 meter distance master. This is my go-to rod over 60 meters. 4 meter distance master. I've got here an extremity 620 reel and I've got a helicopter rig. Now, you're probably thinking, why haven't you gone for the free running rig, Lee? The reason is the helicopter rig just stops me getting in any tangles when I'm starting to fish at a distance. When I'm casting further, I'm punching the feeder further, there's more risk of tangles and a helicopter is going to help me eliminate that. But the approach is going to be the same. I'm going to put a small amount of bait on each line and basically I'm going to rotate those swims. So I might have an hour, 40 minutes at 30 meters. If I don't catch anything, I'll come off it and we'll drop onto the long line. Maybe I'll have an hour there. If I catch 5 or 6 bream, maybe we'll have 2 hours there and we'll try to keep the short line topped up. We're gonna work really hard between those lines to hopefully keep fish coming. And that's today's plan. We're gonna use different types of feeders to introduce bait in different ways. We're going to have a method available. We're going to have traditional style feeders available. We're going to keep those lines topped up and hopefully show you how to keep a few bream coming on these fantastic waters like Rudyard Lake. So let's have a little look at the baits that we're using today. Whenever I go bream fishing, I tend to carry with me very similar baits nearly every time I go, because I know they're baits that work really well, and it's just finding the combination of those baits to get the best out of it. So let's start with the ground bait first of all. I've knocked up something that's a little bit different for me today, but I know it's a mix that's been working really well, and I've been trying it the last few matches, and I've caught a lot of fish on it, so just thought I'd try something a little bit different. It's a fish meal based mix. If you're fishing anywhere for bream, in my opinion, certainly in England, it's fish meal, and so many other places as well. Even if the venue is natural, they just love this sort of ground bait. So I've gone for two parts F1 Dark to one part Super Crush Green. A lovely mix. That Super Crush Green is a little bit tackier than F1 Dark, so it just holds it together, look lovely. It's a beautiful sort of dark green colour, which is a colour that we know works so well on so many venues. It smells great and it's nice and fine. So I haven't mixed it particularly wet. I've mixed it quite dry. I always mix my mix dry for feeder fishing, and then I like to add water as I go just to feel my way in. But I've got plenty of that mixed up with me today. I brought with me two pints of casters. Here they are, beautiful shells. Again, bream fishing, casters, these baits go hand in hand. Some venues not, but particularly on a big natural venue, I wouldn't be without casters. And then I've got with me some worms. Got a nice tub of worms here. Look at that, the old worms. Look, great big fat dendrobinas, perfect. They're going to be hook bait, maybe feeding a few. And then got some maggots with me here, and all I did, dead easy, these are dead maggots, and all I've done is I got a pint from the tackle shop yesterday and I stuck it in the freezer overnight. Just one night in the freezer kills them all stone dead without ruining the bait, so they're all perfect and ready. So worms, casters, maggots, hand in hand with bream fishing. But of course I've got to have with me some pellets, so I've got some 2mm pro feed pellets, which I've just covered in water this morning and allowed them to soak the water up. So now they're nice and swollen. They've taken on plenty of water. They're nice and soft. Bream cannot resist these. And I'll be ploughing these in today through the ground bait to try and create something to hold the fish. And I wouldn't go anywhere without trusty F1 corn. Lovely, sweet corn. It's really, really nice. Works really, really well. And I wouldn't go bream fishing without corn. I just cannot tell you how important it is. Even if you're putting one or two grains in at a time, those flecks of yellow make a huge difference. And then I've got my working area that I'm going to sort of work with these baits for. So let's talk about how I'm going to start the swim in terms of bait. I'm going to put a few feederfuls in at the start, and we'll touch on that. But the actual bait I'm going to use to do that is quite straightforward. So what I'll do is I'll take a hand, probably use my cup, okay? And I'll take a cup full of the ground bait and pop it in there into my bowl. I'll then take, I'd probably say something like half a cup of pellets. There we go, just half a cup of pellets. Pop them in the same tub. And then probably around about half a pot of casters as well. Got those in there, look. And pop them in. And then just flick a few bits of corn in for colour, and I'm going to mix that round, and this is going to be my initial feed. This is the feed that I'm going to introduce on both lines to start with. No worms, just this lovely combination of baits there, look. So that will effectively put a carpet on the bottom of some baits that the fish can patrol over, and I'll put those in. I'll sort of have a little think about while I'm setting up how many I'm going to put in on each line. But this will be the tub, and I'll use that tub. And once I've used that bait, I will then get a completely fresh tub with just ground bait in and add baits as I go while I'm fishing. This sort of mixed tub is just there to introduce that initial bait into the peg. So you can tell that these are really breamy style baits. It's not a roachy ground bait or anything like that. Just nice baits that bream love to eat and will hopefully hold the fish in my peg. You know, if we're going to get lots of bream coming in, they're going to eat lots of bait, so we're going to need this sort of bait going down on the bottom to start with. And those are the way I'm going to use these baits for this session. So I'm going to introduce some bait now at the start of the session. And we've obviously looked at the baits and we've looked at what we've got. And like I've said to you, I'm gonna do this sort of ground bait micros and casters and a little bit of corn to start with. I'm not gonna feed too much worms. I wanna use worms throughout the day. It's always how I like to approach my bream fishing. And I'm not gonna go nuts. I'm gonna put 5 or 6 feederfuls on each line. Now, I wanna touch on how I'm gonna do this, because there is a place for baiting up rods if you're gonna use big baiting up feeders, but we're not gonna fish like that today. We wanna fish nice and accurate. We wanna fish nice and regular. So I'd usually look to a sort of cage style rocket feeder to introduce my bait. And conditions tend to dictate my choice on the type of feeder I use. So I've got the actual rod that I'm fishing with. So we know the distance is really accurate. And here I've got a good example of two different types. I've got a large hex mesh rocket feeder in 30 grams. And this is what I would use if I was going to pre-bait the peg and there was no wind, or the wind was off my back, the wind was in my face. I just use this feeder because I know that I can cast it easily to that distance. It's going to carry a nice amount of bait and get down to the bottom nice and quickly. However, the wind's a little bit tricky today because it's coming across me and I can feel it's quite a stiff breeze. And I know if I chuck this larger feeder out, the chances are I might get a bit of a bow. I might also find that it drifts to the right slightly because it's not heavy enough. So I've picked up a 40 gram medium hex mesh. Now this is going to keep its line much more. It's slightly smaller as a feeder, so I might need 6 or 7 feederfuls rather than say 4 or 5. But I know I can be much more accurate because I've got slightly more weight on the bottom. I understand that you might be thinking, well, why not put a 40 or 50 gram in the large on? And yeah, there is a scope to do that, but again, that feeder is quite big and I would probably need 50 gram to have the same accuracy. And I'm not sure that my rod is capable of casting a 50 gram large feeder every single time accurately. So I'd rather do it with a feeder that's going to be super accurate than I would put that bigger feeder on. And then it's up to me then how accurate or not I choose to be. So I'm going to do that now, probably speed it up a bit for you. So I'm going to basically, that mix that I've shown you, that's got the casters in, it's got the pellets in, it's got the corn in, just gonna have a little play with it here now, get it nice and right. I'm going to put that in at the start and give myself a nice bed to fish on. I'll load this feeder up and I don't over squeeze it. It's not deep. It's about 9 or 10 foot deep, I'd say, out there. There she is, look, ready to go. Few casters, few micros, odd bit of corn. And hopefully I'll be able to give a nice accurate area. I've got my far bank marker there. I'm just gonna put these in. So looking at my target, punching the feeder out, super accurate on the money, no concerns there at all. Gonna let it get to the bottom, and then I'm just gonna give it a little shake. And I know with the sloped sides of those hex mesh feeders, where the lead is at the bottom, that bait is emptying clean straight away. I can actually feel it as I give the feeder a little shake. So I'm just gonna do that now. I'm gonna feed 6 or 7 of those on both lines, get some bait in, and we'll all be ready to start fishing. So I've had an interesting start. I've probably had 6 or 7 casts now, 5-minute casts. I've actually put a worm on now, and I'm getting a bite every single chuck in. So you must be thinking, oh, he's got loads of bream. Well, unfortunately not. I'm getting a bite every single chuck in from nice perch, which is nice. That, you know, they're not all small. I've got a couple of like 8-ounce fish that they're nice, but it's not what I've come for. However, it can happen on these venues, and I often tend to think if you're catching those perch like that, that's probably because the bream aren't there. So I've got to have a little think about what I'm going to do to try and avoid it. Now, I've got a great big worm on this time, which I still think those perch will eat, but they definitely seem to favour the maggots. What I'm going to do is, if I catch a perch this chuck, I'm actually going to change to that method feeder, because I think that method feeder will be a lot more compact. I'll have the hook bait nice and protected. Look, my tip's rattling there now. Look, got a perch on. Oh, might be on, might be off. Not too sure, little tiny perch if it is on. And that's like literally 30 seconds on the stopwatch. So I don't want to keep casting in all the time. I don't want to be putting loads of bait. I tell you what, I've done myself. It's not a perch this time. Look, little skimmer. Hey. But it is little fish. And I really don't want to be casting all the time because I feel like those smaller fish are going to just come into the peg more and more the more I cast. I actually want it to settle down a little bit. So I'm going to change the method feeder. I'm going to get my method rod out and I'll show you how I go about loading that up. And we'll chuck that into the swim and just see if there is a bigger fish there and if that little bit of quieter time makes those smaller fish back off a little bit. So let's have a little look in detail at this method and what we're actually going to do. So I'm going to start off, because we've introduced some bait into the peg, I'm going to start off with the small ICF method feeder in 30 gram. That's going to be enough to cast to where I'm fishing, and I don't want anything too heavy, like I said before, to bury into the silt. We've got the 13 hollow in there. I've actually gone for a 5-inch hook length, slightly longer. When I'm bream fishing, I do like a slightly longer hook length. 018, a bit thicker, you can get away with it when you're fishing a method, and a size 12. What are we going to do for bait? How are we going to get that loaded up? Now, what I've done is I've got a separate bowl and I've put a nice big handful of the ground bait in there. I'm not going to use the ground bait on its own though. You can use the ground bait on its own, but I always like to have some micros around it as well. I do feel like then I am leaving a bit of feed in the peg if I have to have 5 or 6 casts with it. So I'm going to put probably a third of the amount of micros to the ground bait. So we're probably now 2/3 ground bait, 1/3 micros, and just give that a nice stir around in there. A few more micros just to get that balance right. Now, the ground bait's relatively dry and the micros are nice and soft through. So when I squeeze it, it'll bind nice and tight, which is just what I want. You've got to remember, this isn't a shallow commercial fishery. This is a deep natural lake. Therefore, when I punch that feeder out and it hits the surface, it's got to take that impact and get all the way down to the bottom. You can't afford for your bait to be breaking off. So I won't be loading my feeder in advance. I'll be loading it fresh every single time, so I know it's perfect every time. And I'm actually going to put 2 maggots on because I don't want to put a massive hook bait on, because I want the bait to hold nicely on the feeder. And I worry that a bigger hook bait might actually push a bit of that bait off. So I'd have to use a larger method if I was going to do that. So what I'm going to do is put a few bits of ground bait and pellets in the bottom, not a lot at all. The reason I've done that is because I want a little bit of protection for my hook bait when the feeder hits the water. And then I'm just going to overload that mould just like that, so it's nice and full. Push that down so it's nice and compact within that mould, and then press my method feeder on top. And because my mix is dry, I know it will break down nice and quickly when it gets to the bottom, but I'm going to mega squeeze it hard because of the depth. I've got to make sure that this is really, really squeezed on. So really give that a hard squeeze. And there you have it. Look, a perfect method feeder, ready to load on. It's going to go down to the bottom like that. And when it gets to the bottom, it's going to break up nice and fast and expose that hook bait in a perfect pile. Hopefully, that'll give us a little bit more protection from those other fish, and because nothing's breaking off it on the way down, it might not draw these smaller fish to where we're fishing. Let's have a go and see how we get on. We are 6 minutes into the first method, Chuck, and we are attached to something that isn't a perch. So it's a bonus, and it's worked. I got a couple of indications, and I thought, definitely didn't look like small fish. Now, I'll be honest, the bite itself was a bit small fishy. It looked to me like it was a small fish. And I thought, you know, I thought I was going to pick up and be attached to a perch, but it was actually this big fella. There he is, look. This big fella was shaking my feeder on the spot. And it just goes to show how effective a little switch can be. I'm a bit trapped up under me doodah there, look. We're sorted though. Look at that, absolutely nailed him, first chuck. What an absolute result. Look, on the method, first chuck, double maggot. I'm really, really pleased about that. A cracking fish, probably about 3 pounds. I'm gonna slip him into the keep net. And it shows what a difference it can make. You would have said there wasn't one there. It seemed like there wasn't one there at all. And I was even lacking a little bit of confidence when I picked that rod up, because I was thinking to myself, oh, it seems another small fish. And it shows how those bigger fish can be there, and a change in presentation can work. So I'm absolutely over the moon with that. I'm going to get back in with this method and hopefully catch a few more before we have to change and tweak things again to keep those fish coming. So one thing that's going through my mind right now is I've noticed that I haven't had any more indications on this method. This is another couple of chucks, and I'm thinking about that longer line, and I wanted to explain to you today how important it is to use your two lines. I always try and keep my second line quiet for that little bit longer, and if I don't get any indications on this, I'll actually be quite happy, because I won't go on my long line. I will actually change back to that feeder approach, the normal feeder approach, because maybe those smaller fish have just quietened down a little bit. But what I will do is put a couple of feederfuls in on that long line just to top it up, because if there is some small fish out and about, there is a chance that they've eaten quite a bit of that original bait. So the options would be to actually pick that longer rod up and go longer and actually have a fish, or to top it back up, because we're an hour in now, and I don't want to leave it any longer than an hour after that initial feed. You know, if I leave it 2-3 hours, it's a little bit unrealistic. You know, some bream could have come in and just cleared all that bait out. There's obviously some small fish in here, they could have cleared it out. I don't want to leave it, so I'm either going to have to fish it, I'm either going to have to pick that rod up and get out there and fish it for, you know, after an hour, or I'm going to have to put a couple of feederfuls in just to act as a top up. And because I've had a bream just now on this, it's given me confidence to stay on this line for another half an hour, be it with the normal traditional feeder or a method. So in order to buy me that extra half an hour, I'm going to put a couple of feederfuls out longer. And that will allow me then to potentially go on that line if I need to, if I don't get a further response, or if I catch another couple of bream on this, I can stay on this a bit longer with the confidence to know that there is more bait out on that longer line. This one's come in quick succession, you know, because I love the bites on the method, by the way. I was just gonna get all excited there, and it sort of pulled round slowly and then dropped back, and it almost looked stereotypical liner, but then when it started tightening up again big time, I knew it was on. And it's really proven itself, the method, today. I mean, I've had good days on the method in the past, but sometimes that normal feeder outfishes it so much that a method's a waste of time. But this has done, so far it's proven itself, and that's because of the other fish in the peg. It's giving that totally different form of presentation. And if I can get it nice and accurate, nice and compact, right on the money, I feel there's a really good chance. Oh, it's a big one as well, big boy. Woohoo! Absolutely brilliant, look at that. I'm gonna dive at him, got him. Absolutely brilliant. It shows what you can do. You know, that is a cracking bream. I've got my landing net caught again, haven't I, on these rocks behind. Never mind. Look at that. Get over it. There we go. That's a cracker. What an absolutely cracking fish. Brilliant bite. It was great to feel that rod bend round. That elastic gave me the confidence to play the fish, really sort of like kept the pressure on all the time. I'm gonna hold him up for you because he is a beauty. Look at that, I've got to waddle him out of the net. You're gonna behave for me, hey? Wow. That is what bream fishing on naturals is all about. What an incredible fish. Fantastic. Right, I'm going to slip him in. Oh. I think I'm going to stay on this line now. Funnily enough, there's no way I'm going to turn down one of them. But before I do, I'm going to put two feeder falls on that long line, keep that long line topped up, so when I do go on it, I can hopefully have that superb finish. I'm going to see if I can catch another couple on this, and then we'll look at that longer line. The method is delivering the goods, I tell you. It's unbelievable now. There's signs of fish in the peg, and as soon as I'm getting a sign of a fish, I can tell that it's going to go round. I've got the confidence because I've had these fish when I've had an indication. For me, that's always a fantastic sign. So if I'm fishing on a venue and I get indications from fish and I catch that fish within a minute or two of the indications, it gives me huge confidence in the technique that I'm using. And I know today that I'm using the right technique at this time, because as soon as I do, these fish, another great fish look as well, these fish are pulling the rod round. So that's what's happening. The rod is just being pulled round straight away within no time after getting that indication. And it's a perfect sign that what I'm doing is great. And with any sort of bream fishing, I've had to wait a little while, but I've now just had 3 and 3 chucks. Look at that, another cracking rudyard bream. What a fish that is. All perfectly hooked right in that bottom lip, size 12 and 30. Brilliant. We're on our way to putting a cracking bag together here. Like I've said before, I'm fancying a few more while they're feeding, but all the time I've got in my mind, just because of the way I fish and where I go fishing, I've got in my mind, what's gonna happen if these fish go? That 3 and 3 chucks might be the only 3 I catch. I might catch 4 or 5 in the next 4 or 5 chucks, I don't know. But I've got that other line there. I've got that line ready and weighted. Well, we're in the middle of the golden run. I've just had 4 in 4 chucks. And that is what bream fishing can be like. Fish can just rock up as quick as that. Now, as enjoyable as it is, and the method's really good, I want to switch to the conventional style feeder. And the reason being is that when those small fish were there earlier, I just couldn't get away from those small fish on this method. Now, obviously, if I was in a competition, I would be always sticking with what I was doing that was catching me the fish. Let's not, you know, go away from that. But because we're here today, we want to show how effective some of these methods can be, I'm just going to try and mimic what I'm doing with a conventional feeder, because it might be that we get a bite that bit quicker because the fish might see the hook length dropping behind it. So I put 3 red maggots on, I had 2 on a method, and I've just filled my feeder with that same combination of mix that I had on inside the method feeder. So I've now put basically ground bait with a few micros in, and we'll just go and have a go on this normal feeder, because if they're there on it, we might even catch them even quicker, but it'd be great to see. It'd be great to see if we can actually catch them. Like I say, if we don't catch them quicker, it might just be absolutely solid, because they've definitely arrived. And I just love it when that happens. Look at that, a small fish. Look at that. So that has absolutely proved what we were doing was bang on. I'm really pleased about that, because you know, whenever you go fishing, imagine if I was just sat here fishing with this conventional style today, which you know what, like I've talked about, how effective that is. But obviously, this amount of like small perch and fish like this in this venue is meaning that those bigger bream just aren't getting a chance to get at the bait. The only thing I could potentially do if I was fishing in this traditional manner was potentially, I don't know, put a piece of corn on or a bigger worm or something like that. Let's just try maybe a different hook bait. Let's go for a couple of casters even. Something that maybe isn't quite as attractive to those small fish. It's hard, isn't it? Maybe I should be fishing with a smaller hook bait. But the main lesson is, of course, that method is really a very, very dominant way and just cannot be overlooked when you come to these sorts of venues. Obviously, where it's allowed, it's not always allowed, but most of the time it is. But where it is allowed, it is just so deadly. And that has really proved it to me, just making that change there. So it'll be interesting to see this time, just change the hook bait. You know, I'm not one to just rest on my laurels. I like to keep working, seeing what's happening. You know, I do love catching fish on this sort of more traditional style. Maybe a piece of corn might be good as well. But obviously that method has been just absolutely brilliant so far. The change of hook bait has worked. The change of hook bait has worked, and that is probably my fastest bite today. What we got on the stopwatch, 1 minute and 10 seconds. So you can see there how effective that's been. It's just a hook bait that didn't give the smaller fish a chance of picking up the bait, and straight away I'm into a better fish, which is absolutely fantastic. This is why I love fishing so much. I love this style of fishing, because when you're fishing like this, you can really start to see how little things can make a huge difference into the day you're having. You know, those maggots or worms on the hook were proving less successful. Maybe I even need to put like a bigger hook on. Maybe if I put a bigger hook and a couple of big worms on, that would be better. You know, all these little things that I love doing and love making those changes. But these boys have rocked up here now. Look at the action on that rod. That's just cracking. Do love catching bream like this. Look at that in the sunshine. What a day we are having here. What an absolute venue this is. Another great big bream. Got him there, look. And it can be so easy as well. It can be absolutely so easy. There we go, got it. There he is, look. Look at these fish, they're just absolutely cracking as well. I mean, this is probably a 3-pound fish. It's not a particularly thick fish. I think these must be quite young fish because they're immaculate. You know, we're coming into autumn, they haven't packed on weight yet. They're, you know, this is just after a summer where they're all proactive. You know, I expect those fish will probably be 4-pound plus once winter time comes and they put a bit of weight on. But beautiful fish in here, beautiful. So we're going to have our first chuck on the long line. Been priming it all day. 45 gram medium caged window feeder. That's what I'm going for. Just feel like I want to keep everything a little bit more compact for this first chuck if there is one waiting. Got a probably a 70 centimeter hook length, but by the time it's hanging down, it's about 55. Size 12 on, a little bit bigger on this bigger rod. An 016 AccuPower. 3 red maggots, why not? Let's see, we're 63 meters. Nice stiff breeze blowing across us, so we'll try and allow a little bit for that. There we go. On the money. Good chance, good chance. So this is all about the fact that we've just allowed this line to settle over time. We're trying to get the fish to relax and sort of start grazing on a bed of feed somewhere away from anything that's happening. And that's why using this line can be so effective. This is the sort of line that we might catch 4 or 5 and 4 or 5 chucks. My last few chucks on that closer line had just gone a bit funny. So those 2 big feeder fulls I've put in now, they should hopefully hold the fish there or help them regather there. That's obviously the best line, you know, if the fish are confident to be there, but they might just have backed off onto this longer line. So long was an interesting little period. Managed to catch one first chuck. not a massive fish, about 2-2.5 pounds, which was a great sign. And I thought, here we go, we're gonna get this golden run. But unfortunately, it just hasn't happened. And I sort of lost one or foul-looked one, and then they've just not been settled. And to be fair, I feel like with this bright blue sky, this fabulous sky we've had all day, I just don't think they're settling in that slightly shallower water of long. So I'm gonna have a go back on this shorter line. I've been weighing up whether I was gonna chuck with the normal feeder or not. I think I'm gonna chuck with a method to start with, because the method is nice and compact, and if there's one or two settled there, it should be a way of guaranteeing them for that good run. So here we go, I've put double maggot back on. Let's see. Yep, we've gone in okay. So let's see if we can get one on this, because you have got to read the conditions. You can imagine if it was overcast, maybe some bigger waves on, perhaps those fish would be in that slightly shallower water. And today's been all about exploring how effective two lines can be. And I really do believe that in the right conditions, on another day, that longer line could have thrown me up some fish. But as it happens, just that one. I have put a couple of feederfuls in again, so I might continue to sort of flip between the two, but it'd be great to finish now. Hopefully a little spell. If we could catch a couple more on this method, that'd probably take us up to 10, 11 bream. And what a fantastic afternoon's fishing we'll have had here. It'd be absolutely cracking. So we'll see if this method can chuck up and see what it brings. Well, I cannot believe what a wonderful day I've had here at Rudyard today. This place is absolutely stunning. And to catch bream in these surroundings has been a brilliant, brilliant day. Now, what we really care about though is what we've learned, because I think today has really opened my eyes. I really fancied the traditional feeder to be my primary fish catching method. But as you're gonna see with this last fish, the method has been the dominant way to fish. Look at that one to finish. Get in. It has been the way to fish without a shadow of a doubt. And that is purely because I think I'm pleasure fishing here today. And I think a lot of small fish are in the peg. And every time I've tried to fish a traditional feeder for any length of time, what's happened is the fish have basically, the small fish move in and my bait gets damaged. Whereas when you're fishing with a method, your bait is all protected, and it's worked absolutely brilliantly. Look at that to finish. I could not have enjoyed this session more. Let's get them out, have a little look at what we've caught, because it's been absolutely brilliant.
Hi, I'm Andy Finlay, and today we're at the amazing Glebe complex to show you some super simple tactics. Let's go and have a look now. Two simple tactics I'm going to show you today revolve around using hard pellets. I've got a bag of 8mm thin perfect feed pellets here today, and these work on every fishery, every commercial fishery that you can go on these days. These are possibly the best bait. This bag full here should do me today. You know, I'm not going to be feeding lots and lots of bait. It's just a light feeding method and methods I'm going to use. It's not an expensive way of fishing, but it works on every commercial. So the first approach, I'm going to be starting on the bombing pellet. It's a devastating tactic, on the right peg, on the right lake. Wins loads of matches, but feeding's key. So I'm going to use a marker. I'm not clipped up like you would for feeder fishing, but I'm using a direction marker, which is in that clump of reeds, and I'm casting between 2/3 and 3/4 of the way across the lake. just burying the line. It's not that important to tighten up, so you've got a bend in your tip. As long as you're in touch with the lead, like I am there, you'll see my butt ring is this side of the rest there. Stops your rod getting dragged in. With this sort of method, especially as I've got my rod positioned there, it's dead easy to get your rod pulled in. So you could use a gripper rest like I've got on the back leg, or you want your butt ring right next to your to your rod rest head, and that prevents it, you know, it cannot be pulled in, don't matter how ferocious the bite is. So it's just going to be a continuous stream of 8mm pellets, roughly where I've cast me the lead in. You can see there's fish. I've only been feeding a few minutes and already there's fish on top. I might have to feed heavier depending on the signs I'm getting on the top, but at the same time I'm getting fizzing off the bottom, so some are getting down there. You can see bubbles coming up. I'm getting plenty of liners already. It's just a case of keeping these pellets going in. Try and get the area as tight as you can and concentrate everything in as smaller area as possible. It's often a slow starter, this bombing pellet is, but once you keep feeding, you know, it's the sound of the pellet and them falling through the water that attracts the fish. So they need to keep going in, and again, as accurate as possible. Every time I feed, it's on that same line, but it's the distance that you've got to try and visualise. Every time you cast out, you know, and try and get your pellets where it's where you think your bomb's landed. Tips moving, you see the line, not so much the tips moving, but because the line's fairly slack going into the water, it's twitching all the time. So there's plenty of fish in the area, and it'll suddenly click, you know, you'll get your first fish or two fish or however many fish, and then you'll start catching regular. You've done nothing different, but the fish have just got more confident. Yeah, I've got one. I think we have. So there we are, we're into another fish. A bit undecisive whether or not that was a bite there, because it dropped back and went slack and then pulled round. But as I say, while we're fishing in line, even your drop backs will pull the tip round at one stage, because it's just pulling the line through the inline lead. Feels a decent fish. There it goes, taking line off the clutch. There's an interesting thing I'm about to say here. A lot of anglers, while they've got fish on, fishing waggler and bomb, they keep feeding while they've got fish on. And while I can do that, I don't do it, because I've done that there. The pellets went a bit far and to my left. So what I prefer to do is wait until you get your fish in and then start feeding again, so you can get them accurate. It's all right feeding while you've got fish on, but they're never as accurate, or especially not when I do it. So I prefer to wait until I've got my fish in and pick the catapult up straight away and get your next pellets on the spot. There's a little chance of getting broken here. I've got a really long hook length on. It's super strong. So when we get this fish in, we can go and have a look on how to tie that. It's a fighter, it must be one of them long sleek commons. It's not a mirror carp. They come in a lot easier as a rule, and they weigh more. There it is, a nicely hooked common. Always keep a bit of tension on the rod tip when you go to unhook your fish. Probably not that much, but it just saves your line wrapping around the tip, risking cracking off on the next cast. Perfectly in the bottom lip there. And it was a common, as suspected, by how hard it fought. Lovely fish. Let's go and have a look at that oak lent. The way I like to fish a bomb and pellet is by using a lasso rig. You can use bands, sometimes you can get them ready tied and just tie them on your rig or tie them yourself, but I think the best rig for bomb and pellet fishing is a lasso, but you have to tie it yourself. So I'm going to show you the way I do it. I think it's the easiest way. For the rig line, the way I set up, I use a long hook length. A longer length of reflow power in 017 is stronger than say a 15 inch or a foot hook length, because you've got the added stretch, as well as when you're fishing, you chuck your bomb and pellet out and it wants to sink on a tight line. So the pellet, because it's 4 foot or so up, however long the hook length is, it's traveling all that time down after the bomb's landed on the bottom, and that intercepts fish on the way down. A fish could follow it down, and a lot of time you get a bite as soon as you've tightened up to your rig. I use a nice sharp size 18 in the KKHB, the new eyed version hair rigging hook. The reason I'm using this pattern of hook today is because you're relying on the fish to hook itself. By using an 18 rather than a 16 or even a 14, or some lads use a 12 when bomb pellet fishing, because it's a bigger hook, it doesn't go in the mouth as easy when the fish breathes the pellet in. But a light hook will go inside, you know, nice deep down inside, and as it tries to eject it or even just try and swim off with it, because it's a small, really sharp hook, it'll go in easy. So to tie the lasso, I just unwind the reflow power and just tie a simple loop, one overhand knot loop at the end of it, like so, and then pull off between 3 and 4 feet the hook length wants to be when it's tied. So pull off a good 4 feet or so and snip it off there with my quorum line snips, and then the end of that needs feeding through the loop that have not tightened up yet. And if you pass it all through until about halfway up the hook length, and then what you need to do then is grab the tag end of the loop I tied previously and the main line as well, and just strangle that loop onto the power line really tight until it nearly breaks. And then it's simply a case then of just putting your finger in the loop and pulling the knot and everything down, and it should slide perfectly like it is doing there until it strangles your finger. But that's as, don't pull it right down just at this stage, because what you need to do now is just nip that tag end off there, because we don't want that anymore. But because of tightening that loop right down, it's not going to slip anymore, so you can get nice and tight with that. And you do need something like this. Scissors aren't really suitable because you want to get it really tight like I've done there. So that is the actual lasso that we've tied. Now there's a bit of a trick to getting it right for the 8mm pellet you're using on the day. So for that size pellet, the really uniform size of pellet, so if you do one out of the bag, it'll be right for it, all the others after it. And what you want to do is just offer the pellet into the loop like so, and just pull it down so it's tight. So there you are, that's the lasso. But it makes it quite difficult to tie the hook on with the pellet still on there. And it is important, the hair length is really important. So what I need to do now is take the pellet out of the lasso to make hook tying easier, because I want that hair really short. So being careful not to open the lasso up, just tease the pellet out of the loop, and that's what you're looking at, the size of the lasso wants to be. And ideally the hook wants to be half inch away from that, so when it's tied, the bend of the hook's nearly touching the pellet. And first of all, with a knotless knot, you need to go through the back of the eye first, and just pull all the hook length through. careful all through the stage of tying this knotless knot. You don't want to shrink that or enlarge the lasso. So that's what we're looking at before I start wrapping the line around the hook. You know, that idea is just to get the bend of the hook near enough touching the 8mm pellet. So what you want to do is trap that with your left hand if you're right-handed. So what I need to do now is whip round minimum of 7 times, going round 8 to 9, even 10 times. It doesn't really matter, as long as you do more than 7. And still pinching the line in the lasso there to make sure it's not shrinking down. You need to find the end of the hook length again. And the same as before, go through the back of the eye and then pull everything through just slowly to make sure you don't knot anything up. I can put that pellet back on now, but you can see that I've got a bit of play to open the lasso up so I can get my pellet in. You can use a pellet bander if you want to, but I find it best just to tease it open with my fingers like so. Or when I'm fishing, if I want to get a soggy pellet off after it's been in the water a while, I just use a baiting needle to pick it off, and then I simply pick a new pellet up and just offer it onto the hair and just pull everything tight around it. So you can see that there. It's just how I explained I wanted it to end up. It's coming straight off the back of the shank, it's exactly where you want it. And looking at that, if a carp takes that on any length, hook length, the weight of the pellet is going to hook the fish. I believe it's not much to do with the tension you've got on your tip. You've cast in right and it's laid on a nice straight hook length. And just the weight bouncing about in the fish's mouth will hook the fish on that small, really sharp hook. So just a few words about the catapult. It needs to be strong, you know, feeding at a fair range here all the time, so it's no good the pouch start breaking up. Or check your elastic, make sure it's been changed if it was wearing. Pouch is very important on a catapult. Like I've said already, up to three pellets allows you to feed accurately. You start putting more in, then you seem to get more of a spread. But 1 to 3 pellets keeps it together, aiming at a marker. Seem to keep together more than putting more in. And it's a non-tangled design. It swivels as you go inside the catapult. It's on swivel, so it can't really... Some catapults, you get the problem of the elastic tangling up like that as the pouch ravels round on the elastic, but that can't happen with this type of catapult. Another little tip with a catapult is depending on what ranges you fish, most of my fishing is done within 50 yards now, so I've just slightly shortened this elastic. It's easier to, if you want to shorten it, is take it off this end rather than where it goes into the body of the catapult. It rarely wears there anyway, so you probably, if you get wear on the elastic, it's going to be on the pouch end. So just pull it off and snip. I've probably took about 2 inches off this, off each piece. And that makes it nice and compact and easy to feed with. So I'm using 8mm pellets today. They're the fin feed pellets. They're a really hard pellet, which I feel is what you want for this type of fishing. You can get other pellets that want to break down soon after they've been in the water a few minutes. But I don't think that's right for hard pellet fishing. Whether you're fishing the pole or the bomb, what you want is a really hard pellet. And I learned a lot about hard pellet fishing, believe it or not, by keeping fish at home. A lot of you know that I keep fish in a koi pond at home. And one end of the pond, it's got a glass window in it. And although I don't feed them this particular type of pellet, it's a floating pellet in 8 and 6mm sizes, which is very hard. But after feeding a few, the fish are coming in and eating them. And you can actually hear the fish crunching the pellets through the glass through the window. So if I can hear that, you know, outside the water, the fish crunching and cracking up the pellets, then that's got to be one of the best attractors you can get for feeding fish in your peg. The other fish obviously hear that and just drags more and more fish in your swim. So, you know, if you get these sort of things in your head, it gives you a lot more confidence about being confident on hard pellet fishing. There's a nice mirror, lovely bite, just went round fast and kept going. Again, never coming off, well hooked that is. Pellet's still on there. I need to take that off when I've put the fish in the net, because you don't really want a pellet on that's just caught your fish. It starts to round off at the ends. So just going through the way you change your pellet, it's a simple process. You can use a pellet bander if you want to, but I prefer to get the old pellet off. I prefer to use just a baiting needle, and keeping your hook length line slack, just dig in the soft pellet because it's been in the water a while, get behind the lasso and just stretch it open and your pellet will come out easily. And you've enlarged the loop. So now it's just a case of taking the needle out, selecting a nice even pellet and just slipping it back on your lasso, like so. First thing to do, I've just put that fish in the net, is feed, because I don't feed while I'm playing a fish for the accuracy. I've already got pellets in my pouch, and out on that line, as near as you think you can get it, two pouches, because it's obvious there's a lot of fish there. I'm getting plenty of liners now. And then pick your rod straight up, and now you've got a target to chuck your bomb onto. So I opted for a 20 gram ICS cube today for the distance I'm fishing out. I'm fishing a range between 35 and 40 yards, which I consider 20 grams is the perfect weight for that. However, if you're fishing shorter, then they're available in a 15 gram size, as well as a 30 gram size for a bigger chuck, you know, anything over 40 yards really. And this is the only lead I use these days. It's a nice, neat, interchangeable setup. The tail rubber comes off for when you can thread it on your line, and also the hook length attachment. It's once you pull the soft rubber bead back, you're left with a plastic hook, and that just simply hooks onto the end of your hook length like so, and then this plastic, the soft rubber bead rather, goes over the hard plastic hook, and then it's a nice neat setup. It'll never come off unless you do it yourself. That's the long loop we talked about, makes it super strong, going down 4 feet of reflow 17 power line onto a KKHB air rigging hook with the lasso tied perfectly for that size pellet, just leaving probably no more than a 10 mil hair so that your hook, the size 18 hook, is right next to the pellet. Well, there you go, another classic bomb and pellet rip round. I hope I've explained some of the finer points in bomb and pellet fishing. As soon as we get this fish in, we'll have a look on the pole. Just going over the key points once again. Keep your feeding as accurate as possible. Remember, after you've cast in, feather your line, get that hook length straightened out as it's sinking. and bury your line at the same time. Try and fish with the rod more or less pointing at your fishing position, and then you've not got to move it one way or the other. Makes for smooth fishing. Your bites are very positive like that. But always remember, either use a grip rest or get that butt ring right next to your rod rest head, so you're not going to pull your rod's not going to be pulled in, because you can get some right vicious bites on this method, which makes it so enjoyable. And this is going to be a nice fish to end on just before we try the pole. Lovely fish to end our bomb and pellet fishing. Let's get on the pole. Right, I've had a brilliant morning on the bomb. Started quite slow, but in the end, coming nicely. Tip going round every cast in the end. But now I'm going to swap to my pole line. I've not really been feeding it because it can be quite instant. It's getting later in the day, so the fish are definitely turning on now. I've just been throwing a few pellets in. One reason I've picked this peg is that I've got a nice reflection from the trees over on the other bank that gives me the perfect target to fish. So I'm going to plumb the depth there, just about where them two pellets landed. What I'm aiming to do is just, as I normally do on this venue, you get quite a steep slope and then it levels out. Just as it levels out, that's a place where I like to fish my 8mm hard pellet. So what I'm looking for is a decent depth of about 5 foot, which this fishery is quite uniform on all the lakes. You've got the same contours on most of the lakes. So there you are, I'm starting with a section behind me. I've got about 6 metres in my hands here, and you can see there I'm a good float's length out of depth, over depth. But I can feel the bottom's got quite a big plummet on here, and I can feel the bottom's quite soft there, but it's got a bit of firmness to it. But as I go out, I expect it to go a bit deeper, but not a lot. So I've just gone out a bit more there, and it's just going down slightly. As I go out more, I'm onto my last section now, and it's just gone a bit more again. You can see some bubbles coming up, only having thrown a few pellets in there. As I keep going out, ideally what I want to be doing, which I normally do fishing any method, is having the end of the pole on my elbow, so I know I'm in the same spot every time. And I'm just a bit more than the body out of the float there, and I've got about another foot to go, which corresponds with just a light shadow of the trees on the far bank that gives me the perfect marker. Right, so I've plumbed my peg up, I'm happy where I'm fishing. I'm fishing about 6 metres out, just at the bottom of the shelf, where these big fish normally come in during the latter part of the day. I believe they're the same fish that you catch on this 6 metre line as you catch in the margin at the end. So you're looking for a good stamper fish, which this 8mm pellet picks out. So I've only fed a few drips and draps while I've been on the bomb. I'm going to pull a pellet on, and now because my float's there, I'll be able to get it really accurate with me throwing, hopefully. So I'm going out with the pole on the end of my elbow, and I've got that reflection I talked about when I was plumbing up, and I'm just dropping the rig in right on the end of that reflection, lowering it down slowly so the pellet's falling plumb down under the float. And now this is a skill. It might start off rusty for a start, but I'm feeding two pellets at a time, two 8mm pellets, and I'm trying to hit the float. Now that's a bit to the right, which ain't too bad, but it's not good enough. And it is all about, same as the bomb, you know, get as accurate as you can with your loose feed. It It's quite surprising. I've caught lots of fish today. Firstly on the bomb and pellet. Not feeding a lot, three or four pellets at a time. And although it was iffy for a start, the fish settled down towards the end of the session. And they're getting one just about every chuck in. Just by feeding three pellets at a time, keeping them as accurate as possible, and to be fair, I'm feeding less than that on this pole line, and I'm catching fish like this now. It doesn't seem right, but what I was talking about when I was fishing the bomb, about the fish, you can hear the fish crunch these pellets up, where I can when I'm at home watching my fish, which I spend a lot of time doing. And I believe, although you only feed in a few pellets at a time, they're obviously getting eaten, and the other fish can hear that. They can hear them crunching up the pellets, and they just come in to see what's going on. Catching this size of fish, you know, it's more likely that you've been feeding a lot of bait for them to come into the peg and stay there, but this is completely the opposite as what you'd expect. But I believe the fact that the other fish can hear the fish crunching up the pellets is the great attractor. Right, my pole setup is as simple as it can get. Starting at the hook end, I've used a new 6-inch 15 centimetre hook length, the XSHB in size 16 for hard pellet fishing. And up from that, because I'm using a carp pellet float in a 414 size, that takes a bulk of 6 number 8 stops. And believe it or not, that is the only shot I've got on the rig below the float. I don't mess about with any droppers while fishing with an 8mm pellet on the pole, because the weight and size of an 8mm pellet is as heavy as a number 8 shot. So I can't see there being any point in putting anything smaller than a number 8 on the rig line. I'm fishing this dead depth, probably just half inch or an inch over. So I'm right in touch, the line's coming straight off the bottom of my 8mm pellet, and it's registering on the float, similar to really to the way that you fish paste. And what I'll be doing when I'm fishing, when I get down fishing the pole, I'll be throwing just a few pellets and trying to hit the float. Now, if I can do that and consistently do it right, that means that the pellets are going to sink straight past my float, end up on the bottom, the hooks, because I'm fishing dead depth, my hook's directly under my float. So then pellets are landing right next to my hook bait, which is what I consider, you know, the right way to fish an 8mm pellet on the pole on this fishery. Just a few words about the float. It's one of the new carp pellet floats. Really strong float for bagging waters like we're doing here. Incidentally, this float has caught over £400 last weekend, over 2 days, and I've rigged it up again for today. So that just shows you how strong they are. Its construction is of a foam body, a really durable foam body, and it's got like a knot-eye wire stem. So it's a wire stem, but it allows it to bend nearly double and just straighten up the same. As well as that, the wire stem travels right through the float and is glued into the tip, which is a hollow plastic tip, which is the right sort of tip for hard pellet fishing. You want some buoyancy in the tip, you know, to establish your liners from your bites. And another really brilliant feature about this float is, although you can hardly see it, it's got a small eye that travels around the wire and the plastic that you can get your line through. And it's never going to pull out because it is round the stem and the plastic tip. And moving on from that, doesn't matter if it's flat or there's a ripple on the surface of the water, always fish with a back shot. A lot of anglers don't think this is necessary because it's a hard pellet, and I agree, it'll staple itself to the bottom. It's not going to move anywhere. But just by burying the line with a back shot, not making it tell on the float, just keeping, it's there just to keep the line under the surface of the water. And that just makes the float work better. I've got it shotted perfect, so most of the bristles are visible. And an 8mm pellet bite is very similar to a paste bite. It just shoots under the speed that the carp sucks the pellet in, because you are dead depth to the pellet, and it gives you an obvious bite to strike at. Don't use a bander, I prefer to just trap the band with the thumb fingernail and pull over the 8mm. It sits lovely on that, just above, hook sits just above the 8mm. And then let's get out there, inch perfect on the fishing position, right distance out, and it pays just to swing your rig a bit further out from where you're fishing, so it lands in a nice arc and the pellet settles on the bottom. And this is a skill. Not the best, but normally if they don't go on your float, have a second go. Because most of the time your second go will get a lot nearer if not on it. Again, you're looking for that sharp stab under rather than a slower version. There, that's a classic bite. I've got a nice fish on here. Again, I wouldn't really feed while I'm playing a fish. I like my float to be there, so you've got something to throw your pellets at. All right, I'm using that reflection as a guide, but it's not the same as having a bristle there to aim at. Just using one of the F1 kits with the right length of blue hollow in, 15H, and you see how it tames the fish. They're not on for long. Just push the hook out of his mouth. It's a lovely bite again. I just lowered that in with a slight arc I mentioned earlier, and just about had it on the day. So because we're getting later in the day now, this is the time this line comes alive. It's good first thing early on, you know, when the fish are there, but they'll soon back off. But it's important to keep feeding it just with an odd pellet, two pellets at a time, while you're doing your other methods, for it to come good at the end. Because when it does, anyone that's beating you, you can just overtake them straight away. You know, these last couple of hours getting fish this size, they're coming in quite easy, and you can double your weight in, well, depending on what you've had, in no time. I think now I've proved the point, I'm gonna fish on for one more fish, and the nets I've got in are approaching the limit now, so I'm gonna have to call it a day. Same again, 8mm pellet. Try and get spot on that same position we're fishing, and two pellets on the float. Just lower it in that arc. I got a fish straight away last dropping, and two pellets hopefully, lovely, just on the float. And there it goes. I hope you can see, it's a really simple method, simple rig, just that bulk, a third the way up from the hook. Depth is important, you know, get it just that half inch or so over depth, so that you're in direct contact with your 8mm hook pellet. But above all that, your feeding's got to be accurate. But yeah, that's the most important thing to this type of fishing. Timing, be there last 2 hours, even though you've fed a bit of baiting all day. But that's these margin fish that are still on this 6 metre line, you know, they're looking for food then. And you get on them and you can do right well. You can overtake everyone in the last hour, because they're all over 6 pound now, these fish are. That's probably the fish of the day to end on that. Amazing 6 pound mirror, well, fully scale mirror. So there you go, belting fish to finish on. I hope you've learned loads about these two really simple to fish methods. I'll see you next time.
Hi, my name is Des Shipp and you join me today at a fantastic fishery called Rookery Waters, and I'm going to show you exactly how I would approach a brand new venue that I've never fished before. You go to a brand new fishery like I have today, it's really important you try and find out some information, especially if you're a match angler like I am. You know, there's lots of information on Facebook. You can go on their Facebook page, you can look at the lakes. They've normally got footages of the lakes. So looking around today, I know there are some lilies here. You know, if I'd have rocked up this morning and brought the wrong elastics with me, I could be in a bit of trouble, especially if I drew a peg like this. So go on Facebook, try and look at the match results, what weights they're catching, and that'll give you good information about what lines, what hooks and things like that. And speak to the fishery owner, Alex Bates. I spoke to before I come up. He's absolutely fantastic. He's got loads of time for people. You know, that's why this place is such a great fishery. You can buy all your bait here. I've bought some cast off in this morning, which have been absolutely superb. It makes it really, really easy. So do a bit of homework, bit of research, and it'll put you dead right before you get to the fishery. Well, baits are really important on any venue you go to, whether you're a match angler or whether you're just a pleasure angler. And speaking to Alex this morning, one thing he has mentioned to me, that the margins on this lake, Magpie Lake, are really, really deep. So these are the baits that I've sort of opted for, really, because they do catch a lot of fish short and in the margins, but they also do catch a lot of fish shallow. So I'll run through the baits that I've opted for today. Now, one bait I did get from Alex this morning from the shop, I've actually got a few pints of casters, because he said they do catch big weights of carp. It's all mostly carp in this lake. They can catch really well on casters shallow. So I've bought a few pints of casters. You know, it's one of them baits that on the day can be absolutely deadly. But as we all know, you can't beat pellets. Carp see these pellets every single day of their life when there's people fishing. So I've brought a nice selection. I've not got any 2 mils. I've got some with me, but I think with him telling me the information that I've got off him this morning, I've opted for some 8s, 6s and 4s. So that's the pellets that I've got. I've got a couple of tins of F1 corn, because we all know corn is a fantastic bait, especially when you're fishing in deep margins. And I've also got some hookable expander pellets. Now, I'm going to show you a little trick later, I think. It's something I do, whether I'm fishing in deep margins or I'm fishing up to an island, which is really deep, is hair rigging some softer baits like corn and some expanders. So let's get the bait back to the peg and I'll run you through all the rigs that I've set up for today. talking to Alex Bates this morning, he did say to me, look, Des, this lake can be mega, mega good for shallow fishing. So I've set up two rigs that I think are going to cover me for today. They've both got the same elastic, 15 Dura slip. And if you look at my peg today, I've got two great big lumps of lily pads, but I don't want to get near them, so I'm going to fish in the middle. But, and that's why I've opted for that 15 elastic. I think that's going to be perfect today. You know, it's not going to overdo it. I don't want to be pulling out a fish. They've both got a 4B10 carp shallow to 019 reef low power, down to a simple bulk of three number 10 stots. And I've set up two different hook lengths. On this one, I've got an 017 to a 16 KKM with a band on, 6 inches long. Now on there, I can put a pella, I can put a banded caster, and they're really important to have that option, because if you do get bitted out, then having a banded caster or a banded pella on can be absolutely deadly. It just stops you catching the wrong fish, which Alex has said to me, there is some silverfish in here, but you shouldn't get pestered. So that's the sort of information I wanted to find out as well. So that's that rig. That rig's set at the moment about 2 foot deep, but I've got an option of going down to about 2.5 foot deep. So I might have to adjust that as we're fishing. I don't know yet. Now the other rig I've set up, like I said, the same elastic, 15 Dura slip, exactly the same main line, 019, a simple bulk of three number 10 stots to 017 to a 14 XSA chook. So it's strong, you know, like I said, I'm gonna have to pull a little bit hard when I catch these fish shallow, or hopefully catch these fish shallow. All pre-tied up lengths, that is, it's really, really simple. It's, you know, there's no confusion. Like I said, same elastic, same float, 4B10 carp shallow, so there's mega, mega strong. So that's the two shallow rigs I've set up for today. Right. The decision you've got to make is where you're going to start. And obviously I've had a little walk around this lake and there's been a lot of fish cruising around. I do fancy starting shallow, which is probably quite unusual really, but I'm looking for them signs. I can't believe how many ghost carp are in this lake, to be honest. I've seen loads of ghosties swimming around and I know they can be quite difficult to catch some days and they fight like hell. But I'm going to start shallow. I'm going to start on one of the favorite methods. I didn't actually put them on the bait tray this morning, but I've got a few cheeky worms out. It's one of the best ways I can think, you know, I can fish with big hooks, thick lines, and normally feeding casters, which is what I'm gonna do shallow today. I just fancy it. It's that time of year when sometimes the fish can switch off, they can go a bit funny, and that's when casters can make a massive difference. And I'm gonna start just on a simple head of a worm, probably about 1.5 inch piece. So I'm gonna get a big thick dendra like that. I'm just going to put that 14XSH through the head, cut it off with a pair of nails, just with your nails, or you can use a pair of scissors. I've probably got a piece, like I said, 1.5 inch piece along. And I'm going to start, use your bait boxes as a marker. I'm starting it about 3 bait boxes deep, which is about, sort of probably about 20 inches, 18 to 20 inches. And I'm only fishing at 11 meters. One, I can loose feed casters there nice and easy, and I can group them together even though it's quite windy today. So I'm going to go out, got a catapult set up, hold your pole. I'm going to give it, I'm not going to feed too much at the start, I'm just going to feed, and hopefully we get a quick response. There is a lot of fish. Oh, hello. That'll do nicely. That was unexpected. I didn't think that was going to happen, to be honest, but I'll take that. If it carries on like that, we'll be in for a mega day. That was a bit unexpected, to be honest. There's only a little carp by the looks of it. But they're the ones that can do you in the snags. Normally the bigger ones ain't too bad. Lovely little common. So what a brilliant start that is. I'm not sure if that's a normal stamper on here, but look at that. Lovely little rookery common. Said size 14 hook. If we can get them shallow like that, it'd be brilliant. So just check, make sure your bulk's in the same place. Let's get another piece of worm on. Put your top kit, and I'm just going to feed a little bit before I ship back out. Probably about 60 casts or something like that. It's quite a few. I'm not going to mess about today, like feeding 10 or 20. It's not going to be about that, fishing for carp. just flick that rig over a couple of times. And I've probably got about a foot of line between my elastic. I'll never bite then. About a foot of line between my elastic and my float. Never bite, but it could be a small fish. So I'm loading my catapult up ready. And what I don't want to do to start with, casters are quite funny sometimes. You can feed quite a lot of bait, but you don't want to keep pumping it in all the time. And obviously we just started, that might just be a bit of a fluky carp, that one. I hope not, but I'm just looking for signs, you know, obviously just starting. There's a bob nut there, I think. And obviously you've got to put up with a bit of that sometimes. Nice rudder, eh? Look at him. They're beautiful. Let's put him in a separate net. Worm's still all right. I'm just sort of, you know, try and settle yourself in. A couple of times, take your rig over. Get your catapult. Just leave it for a few seconds. Oh, I just seen a great big ghostie come up way past where I'm fishing, admittedly. There we go, look at that. And now I've got to go a bit careful with these lilies. I honestly thought that was going to be a small fish, to be honest. Oh my God. Now, it's a bit daunting sometimes, but I'm using a top of the range XS90 pole. But don't lose the plot. Let the elastic do the work. As long as I'm trying to keep it away from these pads, I'm just looking where the elastic's going and try and pull the opposite way. So I'm putting enough tension on it to get the fish to come back to me, but don't lose it. I see so many people fishing pegs like this. They just lose the plot. Oh yeah, look at that. That's a great big ghostie. So that, you know, that carp was on the way to the lilies. I really thought that was going to be a rud then, to be honest. I'd have a rud. Oh yes. If this carries on. Got me side puller just to get some more strain on it, get the fish under the under control. And just try and keep everything low as well when you're playing them. Bit of side strain, try and keep your top kit down. Oh, whoa, that was a bit of bad netting. Because I've got reeds down the inside as well. Hopefully they won't go for them too much. He's actually hooked under the chin, that one. So I think he's come to the bait, tried to snatch it. And I've actually caught him under the chin. Yeah, he's just under the chin, that one. So he's obviously gone in for the bait. And he's probably about an inch down from his mouth. But I've got to go a bit careful trying to hold these up, because these ghosts would be absolute lunatics. But if this is what the day is going to be like, let me try and pick him up for you, because he's an absolute stunner. I'm going to pick him up for long. Look at that. And these are the ones I've seen swimming about this morning. Loads of ghosties. Look at that. Let's get back out and get another one. Well, I've changed a few things around. I'm actually fishing with a pellet on the hook at the moment, because there was a few rudd around. and they're quite crafty actually, the carp. They're not sort of, at the moment, they're certainly not sort of balling up and coming to the feed. I've got to work quite hard for me bites. I'm still feeding some casters and fishing with a pellet on the hook. That's what I said, that's why you need them two. Oh, that was a carp bite. Having them two rigs set up, one with a band and one with a hook. So you get them odd little indications. And I'm just trying to build the peg along, trying to get them, you know, getting in me peg, get more and more fish. I've had a few flicking the rig like that past me pole tip. It's just at the moment, they're not competing. Look at that, see, little bite then. That's on a 6mm hard pellet at the moment. And that's the sort of things you try. I'll just see a boil then. And that's the sort of things I'm looking out for. Trying to get them competing. The wind's a bit awkward at times, sort of blowing at me a little bit. And they're trying to control me feed, not overcook it. At the moment, it just feels like you can't keep hammering baiting. You've got to leave it a little bit like that. If you keep hammering baiting, I'm not sure yet what's really happening. It's like they come in your peg and your feet, there's too much there for them to sort of pick out your hook bait. And that's what I'm saying, just back off. It's not one of them days at the moment, but it might change as we go along. That's a nice fish. I've just put the 13 meter piece up as well. I'm not fishing at the 13, full 13. It's just helping me hold the pole in this side wind. So that's on my other rig with a little band on. And I've been on these venues before, you think, oh, just blather baiting, it ain't one of them days at the moment. But that could change as we go along. You might have to give it big pouchfuls of bait. At the moment, they're not competing like that. They do have scrap in this venue. Oh, he's tangled around his fin at the moment. Let the elastic, I've got bit of elastic out with the pole bung at the moment. Just trying to get control of him. These ghosts are crazy. Lovely fish though. I'm definitely trying to hold this one up if I get him out. It's a beauty. They just go around with their heads drilled into the bottom and their tails out. There we go, look at him. And they pop up like that. So that's on a 6mm pellet, but I might go back to that worm. Lost me disgorger. What I've done with that. Bad angling. Well, I do like disgorgers, using a disgorger quite a bit for carp when they're in the net. Let's hold him up, because it's a lovely rookery ghosty. I mean, I don't think I've ever been to a venue with so many ghosties in it. But look at him. These are the ones, they fight and scrap so hard, but great fishing, and it's fantastic to catch these fish shallow. And try varying how much you feed as well. It's not all about filling your pouch up or your catapult. You know, try feeding sort of 20 casters or 20 pellets, or even less pellets. Pellets shallow, I find, over the last several years. You can't really feed tons of pellets shallow. And casters are completely different. Some matches you can absolutely ladle casters in and they go mad. That's what we want, a bit of fizzing happening. There we go. So hook one, a few sections back, try and get, you know, obviously they're gonna go towards them lids a little bit. Get your pole on the roller. So there is an art to it, you know, it's not all about, like I said, it's not all about blasting baiting, especially at the start of your session, trying to build it up. Got to break down twice at 13. That's why I got that sock there. Great for your bigger sections. And I've got my little butt rest there for my small sections. I'm going to feed a little bit now, if you can. If you don't worry about it. If you're not, try and feed a little bit. You know, you do the same thing if you're fishing for F1s. If you're fishing out of your hand, you try and hook a fish. So there's a few fish stay in your peg. Yet another ghostie. There's a mirror ghostie, this one. Probably quite rare, them fish, to be honest. Don't see many of them where I live. Look at him. Proper strong, though. Got a job to get out of the fish. Little mirror ghostie, not going to pick him up because he's proper wiry. But they fight mad. Well, I'm going to see if I can catch another one, but I'm itching to get down that edge, to be honest. I've been chucking just a couple of 6 mils down there while I've been fishing shallow, but not trying to get the pellets into the bank. Just throwing them sort of 2 foot away from the bank. But this shallow fishing has been really nice, to be honest. It's not been, you know, not been easy. But enough to sort of keep you going. But definitely flicking that bait past your pole tip like that, I think's been the best way up to now. And as we've been fishing, there's a few more bubbles coming up, which I think's great when you're fishing shallow. But it's strange some days that you can fish shallow for carp and you can sit there like you are sort of when you're fishing on the bottom and it just flies under. There they are, typical. Amazing that you can sit there. If you overdo it with the feed, I think it just pushes them down too far and you can't catch. Lovely fish, you know. I like this sort of fishing, especially when we're, you know, just when we're trying to do coaching sort of things like this. Makes it more interesting. So I'm going to get this one out, and I'm itching to get down the edge. Like I said, I've been chucking just 2 or 3 6 mils down there because it is a deep margin. Yeah, another ghostie. Unbelievable. It's like ghostie central. He didn't fight that hard. So there you go. That's the last one I'm going to fish shallow for a while. So get down that edge. Because it's really important. I'm going to show you how I would attack that edge. Woo, crazy ghosty. Let's get him back and let's get on the edge. I've had an absolute fantastic morning fishing shallow, and as it happens, the more bait I fed as it went on, the better it got. But I am itching to get down the edge because it's probably one of the biggest questions I get asked is, Des, I go to a venue with deep margins, I struggle to catch the fish, I foul hook them. So I'm going to run you through the things that I think make a massive difference to conquer deep margins. Like Alex said this morning when I spoke to him in the shop, I've actually plumbed the edges up and they are quite deep. It's literally straight down off the bank, I would say nearly 4 foot. And that's a big problem, or people think it's a big problem. Now that can be the same as when you're fishing over to an island, if you've got that sort of cliff face. Now, one thing I've learned over a period of time is you don't have to fish really light floats when you fish down the edge. It's probably one of the biggest things that I've actually learned over the last 3 years on fishing different venues, such as Rookery Waters. Now the two rigs I've set up for today, I've opted for a 17 Dura slip. It's a bit heavier because I've got a lot of these Norfolk reeds. You know, when I first seen it, it's a deep. I think I'm gonna, hopefully the fish will swim away from the reeds. I don't know. But I've opted the same sort of float really, a little dumpy float. It's called a carp shallow. So it's the same float as what I'm using shallow. That's the good thing about these sort of little floats. You can use them for everything. But unlike the shallow rig, a 4B10, I've got a 4B14 on here. 019 reflow power again. And it's a simple bulk. I can obviously move this bulk around later on. If I go down the edge and I'm getting some liners, I think the fish are off the bottom, I can sort of move these shot around, maybe spread them out. I'm not sure yet, but I've just got a simple bulk of number 9 stots. So I've got probably 7 number 9 stots on a 4B14. Simple, just above the hook length. So where the loop goes on the hook length, I've just got it bulked. The same, I've got an 017 hook length down to a 16 kkm. It's one of my favorite hooks for carp fishing when I'm air rigging pellets and baits like that. So nice simple rig. I've got a medium cab pot on there because I think I'm gonna have to go really careful what I do down the edge. You know, if I start throwing bait, I'm not sure yet. It's something that we'll talk about when we get fishing. Now the only other rig I've set up, similar really probably to what I'm doing out long, just give yourself a couple of options. The same elastic, so it's nice and simple, 17 Dura slip, same little medium cad pot, exactly the same float, 4B14 carp shallow. You could probably even get away with a 4B16 down there, but I've opted for a 4B14 because like I said, if I want to, I can move these shot around a little bit. This rig I've actually just got off the winder. I've not actually bolted these down yet, but what I can do is just move them down exactly the same. That's the nice thing about stots. They don't damage your line. You can move them about. That line's like brand new. So I've got the same hook length on there, 017 bottom to a 16 kkm, but I've got a rapid stop on there. It's something that I do a bit now. I can even air rig a worm, a piece of corn, or even one of those pro hookable expanders. It's really, really important. But what I'm gonna do now is show you how I've plumbed up down that margin. That's one of your best friends on any commercial or any venue, is a nice big plummet. That's 20 grams. That's my normal plummet I use on commercials. It's probably only rivers where I actually use a bigger one, but a 20 gram on normal commercial is absolutely perfect. Now I'm gonna plumb up down the edge and try and guide you exactly what I'm looking for, especially in deep margins. And that is deep. So I'm gonna have a clip plumb around. Now I know I'm over depth a little bit. It's really important you get very close to where your depth is, and it gives you a better guide what you're actually fishing on. So I'm just gonna bring that down a few inches. So that's gone under there. And it's obviously that's a slope because that's just going down and down and down. So I'm gonna bring that right in the bank. Now there you are. So that's sort of dead depth. And there's a nasty little, that's where it starts to come up there. So that is like a cliff face. It's probably actually undercut as well. So I'm just gonna try and find a nice little flat spot, which I would say, just lean out a little bit, have a little plumb round. That's what I say, if you get near the depth you're gonna fish, it makes it a lot easier to understand what the bottom's like. If you have your float stuck out the water like that and try and plumb up, it's never the same. So try and get close to where your depth is and you'll understand the bottom a lot easier. I think that little bit there is lovely. There's a little flat spot, like a bit, probably about the size of a little plate, if you like. A little shelf there, a little curb there, if you like, and it flattens off. I'm not worried about getting right in tight in deep margins. I'm more interested in trying to find a nice little flat spot, like there. I'm just gonna bring that back, just adjust me float up a little bit. And have a look at that. And that'd be no different if I was fishing over to an island. Yeah, look at that, that's lovely. That little bit there, just beautiful that. It just comes up slightly before it actually comes up to like the cliff face. And I'm just gonna put a fraction more depth on that because I always plumb up. So the body of the float is probably about half an inch out of the water. And that's deep. You know, I wouldn't want to get in there. You probably with a pair of chest waders, you'd probably be gone. That's how deep that is. So that is lovely there. There's not much stuff on the bottom. Just feels nice. Look at that, it's beautiful. And that's going to sit there like that when I'm fishing. So body just out of the water as a starting point. The next thing I'm going to do, I know fishing down edges like that, the things I've learned, and it all depends on fishery rules. Here at Rookery, you can fish real short lines. And that's going to be really important when I'm fishing down that edge. I don't really want to be foul looking fish. That's the biggest problem people get fishing in deep margins or over to islands where it's very deep. I'm going to fish probably like 4 inches between the loop of where the elastic is and the body of the float. So I'm just going to tie a double figure of 8 knot there. Make sure you lick it. Just chomp that tag end off. Put that line safe. And put that back on. Because it's not going to be about striking down there, it's going to be about lifting. I actually fished a match a while back and it's exactly the same. I was fishing over by an island, it was that deep, and I literally, every bite I got, it was literally just like that, and they'd be on. So there you go, nice and simple. So I've got my float, sort of 4 or 5 inches between the elastic and the float, a simple bulk, and a 6-inch hook length. So one really important thing is to mark your depth. You know, it's really important. If something goes wrong with your rig during your day, whether you get smashed up in the weeds or anything like that, mark your depth. So just get a nice little Tippex pen like I got. Make sure you've got the mark on there like that. I've got some other marks that I've actually scraped off because I'm quite easily confused. So there you are, nice and simple. But one really important thing is, I mean, if I was to have my elastic like that all day in the summer, that elastic, the sun will destroy the elastic. And we all know, we don't want that to happen. So I've got a rig hookup on there. Great little ideal, heavy duty, so not gonna let you down. So you can adjust these up the section like that. Just bring that down a bit. They've got a little hole for your hook to go in. So you can have your elastic inside your pole and just stops everything getting decayed and ruin your elastic. Well, I'm going to go down the edge now. It's simple. I'm just going to put a 6mm fin perfect pellet on, which is what I've been feeding down there since I've been fishing shallow. I've been chucking 2 or 3 down there, that's all. So there's so little, and I think that's really important when you go down these deep margins. And I'm trying to chuck the pellets away from the bank. What I don't want to do is give those carp an option, really, of going right in against the bank, because they can be a nightmare. So I've got my little cab pot on. I'm going to put roughly about 10 or 12 pellets in, 6 mils again. Just soak them in the water a little bit before we go down there, because I want all them to sink as quick as possible to try and keep these carp down. But I'm not going to pot them in where I'm fishing. I'm going to pot them about a foot away. It seems crazy, but there's a reason for that. I don't want them fish to try and sort of climb up the bank. But some days you might have to fish shallow in a deep margin. But I don't know whether that's going to be the day to day. So I'm fishing a real short line, and the art of it is really not to strike. Let's hope we get a quick response. Like I said, been feeding it for a bit, not a lot of bait, but you've got to be patient sometimes in deep, same as what you would be if you're fishing against an island and it's really deep. It is sometimes really difficult to keep the fish down. So I'm just going to lift and drop. And I like holding my pole like I am. It was like if you were holding a rod. I always find it much better if you can fish one-handed. It feels like an extension of your arm, so it makes it a lot easier to sort of just lift rather than when you've got your two hands on a pole, you always want to strike twice as hard for some reason. When you just use one hand like that, you can just sort of see the bite and just lift. And that's what's so good about air rigging. You know, I've got that option of the other rig where I can put a soft pellet on, a piece of corn, because sometimes we all know it can make a big difference. I go to venues where if they've seen a lot of pellet during the summer, you can put a soft pellet on and it's unbelievable. They'll pick that bait out and you can get one a chuck. We're on a hard pellet some days, it just ain't quite right. But obviously go on hard pellet. Hard pellet's easy, you know what I mean? Easy to fish with. If you miss a bite, it's not going to come off. It's all about being nice and patient. Little tiny indication there, probably a little liner. There we go. Tiny little bite. Didn't even strike, just lifted. Only a small one, I think. And what I'm going to do is literally throw three pellets down there, away from the bank. Just don't give them any reason to come right against that bank. Not when you're trying to catch the fish on the bottom. Bit more powerful elastic. You could probably use this out there shallow if you wanted, but I thought that 15 would have been nice for shallow and 17 down the edge with those Norfolk reeds. And that bulk's really important. When you're fishing a little short line like I am, it keeps that, it's no different to when you're fishing for F1 shallow. It keeps that line tight and it hits you more bites. So I'm gonna go down again. About a dozen 6 mils, something like that. I'm not counting them out. Dip them in the water so everything goes down as quick as possible. And like, you know, fishing in a deep margin like that, you've got to go so careful with baits like ground bait and that. You know, when the temperature maybe drops later in the year, ground bait could probably be a brilliant option. But I just want those bigger baits. That's why I stuck with 6 mils. Because they're heavy, they go down quick. You know, if I couldn't catch, then I'd introduce some 4 mils. Ooh, a little tiny bite then. So just feed away from where you're fishing. You know, you're going to get an odd liner in that depth of water. That's the whole point of fishing a short line, is stopping foul looking. If you're fishing a long line, you're more likely to want to give it a good strike. You're striking up through the water, and you've got a better chance of foul looking, which is what you don't want. And just lift and drop now and again. And you'll know if it's one of them days where they just won't go down. I've got my shallow rig set up that I fished out long. I can just use them down the edge. If it's one of them days, I might have to throw pellets in there because they won't go down. I've got my shallow rigs there. But you've got to go careful that if you go and do that and they won't come up, you can be in big trouble. You can't catch nothing, just foul look everything. Just try and hold it as still as possible, but not affect, there we go, beautiful. So just drag that a little bit, that wind, just push that into that little shelf, because I know it's a little flat bit and it comes up a bit. And when you plumb up, that's what I try and get that in my mind, a little map in my mind of what I'm fishing on. So get that away. Try and keep it away from where you're fishing. Feels like a good fish, that. Give it a little bit of time. 2 or 3 6 mils away from the bank. And like I said, if you're not great at throwing, don't do it. Just use your little pot. I know it's quite negative, but there's a reason for it. Feels like a nice fish, that. And it's so important you can, oh yes, look at that. Big mirror ghosty. Never caught so many ghosties in my life. Lovely fish, that. Oh. Yeah, that's the ones we want. Woo. Try and pick him up. Lost me disgorger again.
I will try and pick him up, because he is a beautiful fish, that. Probably, you know, real rare of them, ghosty mirrors. Don't see that many about, to be honest. There's plenty in this venue. I'm not going to pick him up for long, to be fair, because he's wiry. But there you go, you get your margins right. And catching these fish is an absolute doddle. Get him back. Right, we've been down the edge and it's been brilliant. I've not actually fouled up the single fish. You know, doing what I'm doing, chucking them 2 or 3 6 mils in, sort of 20, 30 seconds after I've hooked one, go in there, filling that cab pot up with probably, you know, between 10 and 15 6 mils, away from where I'm fishing, has been bang on. But one little tip, which I've been doing for a long time, is the air rigging. Like I showed you at the start, having the rig made up with a rapid stop on. I've just gone down there. I've got one of the hookable expanders on. And some venues you go to, you've got, you know, meat and corn, soft pellet is better. If you air rig it like that, fish a short line like I'm doing, you know, you catch the right fish. So let's have a go with them. I'm sure we'll catch on it. But the nice thing about air rigging is you don't have to strike. It's like air rigging a hard pellet or a banded pellet. But on some of the venues I go, you get a lot of small fish problems, and even if you air rig it, it does eliminate that problem, especially when you're fishing long, actually. So if you're fishing long up against an island, you know, you basically don't come back without a fish on. You're not messing about putting another hook bait on. So I've got my hair rig on there, like the one I showed you earlier. A tad longer line on that. It's not quite as short as my other rig. It's probably like 6-8 inches of line between the elastic and the float. You know what I mean? You could adjust that if you wanted to. But the bites I've been getting on the hair rig, some of the bites are like 1,000 miles an hour. It's like they've sucked the bait in. They've already pricked themselves with the hook and they're off. But you imagine if you're fishing, say for instance, you're fishing to that far bank today, you know, you're getting odd indications, your bait was coming off, especially if you're fishing with meat and corn, you air rig it and you can literally, look at that. I mean, you have to strike then. It's like a straight lead bite. It's like, woof. And that's the difference between air rigging. There's more and more of this happening now and you've got to be prepared to try it. It's only, you know, you can buy the hook lengths pre-tied or you do them yourself. 16 hook is bang on. I use a lot of 16s for this sort of fishing. Absolutely deadly. Bigger fish down the edge as well. Much bigger than ones I've been catching shallow, to be honest, which is unusual, really. As I said, we walked around this morning and there's lots of fish on the top. They've gone down, they're not like on the top they were like they were earlier. They've sort of faded away a little bit. But that air rigging, the bites were so much quicker, so fast. You've just got to be prepared to do it, especially with a venue with all sorts of different sized carp. Brilliant for skimmers and bream as well. And you only want a small selection of hook lengths. As long as you keep them 6 inches. I use 6-inch hook lengths most of the time for carp fishing. For all different baits. Even when I'm fishing shallow. You know, really speaking, we could have air rigged, pieces of worm when we were fishing shallow. Nice little mirror carp. Forgot to feed them 2 or 3 mils. I was talking too much. Just try and feed a couple of 6 mils down there. So I've sat here for a few minutes, nothing. Don't be scared to come back. A little bit more bait in your pot. I just didn't want to throw like 10 pellets down there. Tap them in. That's the nice thing about that heavy rig. It's so positive. You can drag that in. It gets down quick. I've never felt either today down the edge that like maybe moving the shot around a bit from just that simple bolt would make any difference at all. It's been about keeping that tight line, fishing on the deck. I think I've only actually caught one fish where I've sort of dropped my pellets in, I've lowered my pellet, my hook bait in, and the elastic's come out. Everything's been nice on the bottom, waiting, being patient. You get an odd little tiny, odd little liner, and then you get your bite. There you go. But a little tiny indication then, sort of half struck at it, dropped it back in, little dink, and I got it on. Probably them little carp are probably craftier than the big carp, to be honest. They reject the bait so quick. Lovely mirror carp. Just get the fish under control in the net because I've got that rapid stop on there. Let's have one more before I finish. So get your needle in the rapid stop. Nice big 8mm hookable expander. Simple as that, as quick as that. So I'm probably leaving it like 3 or 4 minutes. If I don't get one, I come back, put a few more pellets in me pot. Don't just sit there and sit there. There's being patient and then you've got to feed again. It's like you've missed your opportunity if you don't get one within like 2 or 3 minutes. And drag that in, let that bolt go down. If you had a small float on there, you're just flapping about, look at that. That's a better one. Oh yes. Well, I did say this was gonna be the last one, my last fish, and it feels like it's gonna be a decent fish to finish off with. Oh dear. Just be nice and, I've got to keep away from the pads. Just keep your poles nice and low. Lovely that. What a beautiful fish to finish the day off. If I get him out. Oh yes. Lovely big common. Get him, just hold him up. Get that in there. Well, what a fantastic fish to finish a fantastic day off at Rookery Waters. I've enjoyed it, I'm sure you have, and thanks for watching. Let's get this beautiful fish back. Hi, my name is Des Shipp, and you join me at a fantastic venue called Rookery Waters, New Cambridge. I'm going to show you how I approach a venue. That's my van that's in my mind, see, that scratch. Hi, I'm Des Shipp, and you join me today at Rookery Waters, near Cambridge. I'm going to show you how I approach a brand new venue.
You got it in one.
Just on it, am I? Just it's just that Chinese is like. Blah, 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 blah.
You know, in Tiger Woods, it's a really good golf shot. He goes, just like a Lee Kerry cast, that is.
Said no one ever. So little things like that can put you in good stead before you get to the fishery. Boom!
That's good, that.
Do it again.
You got me there, Joe.
Have I?
You sleep.
Yeah, let us get a pitch.
Look at me in a sec, Des.
Yeah. That's an outtake.
Oh, Joe.
Fucking do one.
Don't know what's more impressive, being in a tangle there or being in a tangle around the fucking
road. Here we are on the table of love.
It's quite a bit of cloud cover as well, which is helping. In the shallow end. Hang on. Nope. A small fish on.
Method.
Yeah. Small fish on method.
Hello.
Yes, method perch.
I don't think I've ever seen a method perch.
Just tell me why I struck at that. Why did I strike at that? Do you know why I struck at that? Do you know why I struck at that? Fucking don't know why I struck at that.
You hear them going on? Northerners, aren't they? Huh? Like you, Joe. And then what you want to do now, just with your finger in it, that should slip down. Just where did the start again?
You close enough, Joe, because I don't.